UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson resigns as Tory leader. He has stepped down amid a nonstop wave of officials in his cabinet resigning. What does this signal for UK politics, and is this a larger signal for EU politics as well? For insight, let's turn to our first guest. He holds the John Jay and Rebecca Moores Chair of History and African American Studies at the University of Houston. He's one of the most prolific writers of our time. His latest book is entitled The Counter-Revolution of 1836, Texas, Slavery, Jim Crow, and the Roots of American Fascism, Dr. Gerald Horne. As always, Gerald, welcome back.
Thank you for inviting me.
So Bojo announced his resignation as leader of the UK's Conservative Party today. He leaves amid several high-profile scandals and following a wave of resignations of senior cabinet members. Talk about the pressure that's put on him from these scandals, as well as the pressure that's being put on him based upon the economic realities, the impact of sanctions and inflation and other elements that are happening in the country as a result of the proxy war in Ukraine.
Well, the economic pressures are quite formidable. And part of it has to do with the ham-fisted policies of Mr. Boris Johnson. If you look at the National Health Service, which in many ways is the pride and joy of Great Britain, that is to say, government-subsidized health care, which probably doesn't even translate in the United States unless you understand something like Medicare, for example. Well, NHS is a kind of mess right now, which is a real blow to the Tories, Mr. Johnson's party. What I mean is it takes months to line up an operation. Because Mr. Johnson spearheaded Brexit, it has become difficult to find nurses and other kinds of healthcare workers. And recall that the emblem of Great Britain, that is to say the National Health Service, was ratified when at the London Olympics there was extraordinarily a considerable focus as a matter of pride and joy on the National Healthcare Service. So certainly that did not help Mr. Johnson's ability to maintain his tenure. And then there are questions of inflation, largely driven, I'm afraid to say, by Mr. Johnson's hawkishness with regard to Ukraine. He was in and out of Kiev so much, I dare say, that he probably was trying to rent an apartment there. And what's remarkable about that is that that in itself represents another wider point, which is that Mr. Johnson was the symbol of Brexit, the epical June 2016 British exit from the European Union. And since Brexit, of which Mr. Johnson pushed so assiduously, Britain has had difficulty finding a role. There's been a lot of talk about Britain trying to re-enter the European Union, but I'm not even sure if the European Union would accept them if they were so bold as to make an application. Brexit also meant that London, Great Britain, was more susceptible to the whims of the United States of America. But a problem there, which Mr. Johnson was trying to address, is that it's very difficult to be an ally of this hawkish United States of America. You inevitably get plunged into conflict after conflict, and that's what Mr. Johnson was trying to do by being so hawkish on Brexit. Then you have these preening and posturing Irish-American politicians like Joseph R. Biden, who object to any tampering by London of the Good Friday Peace Accord. With regard to Northern Ireland, recall that Northern Ireland is a constituent element of Great Britain. And because of that, it has been difficult to effectuate some sort of alliance with the United States of America. It's been difficult for Britain to have better relations with China, although it was well postured to do so. That is to say, China and Chinese interests would be quite willing to invest in Great Britain. But then again, you have Britain being hawkish on the question of Hong Kong, the former British colony, which was reverted to Chinese rule in 1997. And then that led to another issue, because in order to embarrass China, Britain flung open wide the door to Hong Kongers moving into Great Britain. But that ran smack dab into the xenophobic elements in British culture, which has objected not only to the proverbial Polish plumber, but perhaps even more so because they're more readily identifiable to all of these Chinese who were arriving from Hong Kong into London. And then there's the Commonwealth, the former British Commonwealth. It's difficult for Britain to dominate the Commonwealth. And recall, they just had their meeting in Rwanda just days ago, because it seems that India is the natural leader of the Commonwealth, not Great Britain. And as you know, at the highest levels of New Delhi, there's still resentment towards London because of the hundreds of years of British colonialism in that continental-sized nation of 1.3 billion. And London has compromised its policies even more by reviving its age-old hostility to Russia. Now, this is nothing new. It was a constituent element of the Cold War. If you go back to the 19th century, visit for a moment the so-called Crimea War of the 1850s, where London seemingly violated its own principles by ganging up on a so-called fellow Christian nation, speaking of Russia, in alliance with the Islamists in Istanbul, that is to say, the Ottoman Empire. And that has been quite a stumbling block because, as noted, it led to this aforementioned hawkishness with regard to Ukraine, which in turn has fueled inflation, which has eroded the possibility for Mr. Johnson hanging on to power. In some ways, Britain, as symbolized by Mr. Johnson, is still encountering the problem it faced post-1945, when, as the saying went, it was in the process of losing an empire, but had yet to find a role. And that remains the case. That is to say, as the litany I just clicked off with regard to having troubled relations with India, the European Union, the United States, China, Russia, Britain in some ways is reverting to its status before Protestantism descended in London in the 1530s. That is to say, a kind of minor monarchy on the fringes of Europe that's headed towards irrelevancy.
Let me ask you this. When you look at recent politics in Europe, Viktor Orban, a guy who is, you know, he's a right winger. He's opposed to the neocon venture in Ukraine, and he's opposed to the sanctions. He won in a blowout. You look at what happened with Macron. If I'm Mario Draghi, if I'm Olaf Scholz, if I'm the rest of these people that have been all out with this neocon venture in Ukraine, and I look at what happened to Bojo, I'm looking over my shoulder. Put this, Dr. Horne, in the context of, you know, Europe and how these the other leaders have to look at this.
Well, we're going to have to wait and see, because presumably the Tories will hang on to power. It's unclear when the next election will take place. Part of the problem in Britain now, and you see it reflected in the United States of America, is that the opposition Labour Party, there's not that much daylight between the labor rights and the Tories with regard to Ukraine policy. So it's unclear what the fallout will be electorally, and then what the consequences will eventuate in Great Britain itself. But certainly, I think that the United States should study the British example carefully, because the United States, as the self-proclaimed inheritor of the baton passed from the British Empire to Washington post-1945, is now in a process of decline. Soon it will be facing some of the same questions that London has been facing for decades. That is to say, what will its role be as the empire sinks into irrelevancy? And I think I would be remiss if I failed to point out all of the wreckage and damage left by the British Empire. You need only look at historic Palestine. That, in some ways, is a product of misrule and misfeasance in London. If you look at Hong Kong, for example, already noted. If you look at apartheid South Africa, recall that London was the ostensible power there for decades, ever since the Dutch were pushed out at the beginning of the 19th century. And obviously, if you look at India and the historic conflict with Pakistan, that's a product of the rather erratic evacuation of the British Empire from South Asia post-1945. And I think there's a message, too, to our friends in the Caribbean who are pushing London for reparations. And I dare say that I think they'll take advantage of the opportunity. London is on the defensive now. And I think that Jamaica and Barbados and the others clamoring for reparations should kick London while it's down. That is to say, to gang up on London in conjunction with many of these aforementioned antagonists, speaking of China and Russia in the first instance, and drive a hard bargain with regard to reparations. And certainly black Americans, who I'm afraid to say are oftentimes missing in action when it comes to international questions, should not fail to seize this opportunity and tag along with Jamaica and Barbados, because demanding successful reparations from London will obviously have knock-on effects with regard to demanding successfully reparations from the United States of America. So this Bojo ouster is seemingly a minor question, but it opens up enormous vistas for the legions of opponents developed over the decades and centuries by the British Empire and British imperialism.
In fact, thank you, because that's my next question. Does the resignation of Boris Johnson, does it signal simply a problem with Boris Johnson, or does this open the door for the counter to the Tories to take control of policy in Britain?
Well, the counter to the Tories is noted on the labor rights under Sir Keir Starmer. And I'm not optimistic about a prime ministership of Sir Keir, as he might be called in London, because he got into office basically by stomping on the progressive legacy of his predecessor, speaking of Jeremy Corbyn. Notice that in Boris's resignation statement, he was explicit in castigating the parliamentary Tory party. And what he was doing was drawing a distinction with regard to the grassroots and membership where he thought that he still had support. Likewise, with regard to Sir Keir, he has support from the parliamentary Labour Party, but the grassroots, the rank and file, are still in thrall, thankfully, to Jeremy Corbyn. So that's going to open up a battle royal, it seems to me, when and if the next election takes place. And right now it's unclear. And it also raises questions as to who will be the next Tory prime minister. And that, too, is unclear. But rest assured that the restless in Westminster and in London have the knives out. And hopefully that should not be taken literally.
Dr. Gerald Horne, as always, sir, thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate that analysis. You are always so gracious when we call, and we truly, truly appreciate it. We look forward to having you back.